মেডিকেল কলেজে ক্লাস তো ওখানে আরেক সময় দুটোর সময় দিতে যা শুনবো একটু বাইরের সাউন্ড কম আসলে কান থেকে ই করে নেব না দাও চলে গেছে ওখানে হ্যাঁ কামরুল, আমি শুরু করি নাকি? দেখো কয়জন উপস্থিত, দেখো আগে একটু দেখে নাও। হ্যালো, থ্যাংকস এভরিবডি টু পার্টিসিপেট ইন দ্য মর্নিং সেশন অ্যান্ড আফটার এ লং টাইম উই হ্যাভ স্টার্টেড আওয়ার ক্লাসেস। প্রবাবলি অল অফ ইউ আর ভেরি ফাইন অ্যান্ড সেফ। টুডে উইল ডিসকাস রিগার্ডিং দ্য সার্জিক্যাল সাইড ইনফেকশন অ্যান্ড সার্জিক্যাল ওন And I am expecting that all of you will participate in the class, as because it is a very nice and important session for the clinical student. As because we know surgical site infection is the most commonest and complicated complication of surgery. Till to date, no surgeon could face the infection. Every surgeon everywhere in the country, and it is a global problem. That is, surgical site infection is a global problem. But with the different steps, we can reduce the surgical site infection. As we know, first the surgical site infection, this regarding this infection, Egyptians physician were aware of this infection before the birth of Christ, and about 4000 to 5000 years back, Egyptians first described regarding the surgical site infection or infection in their medical book papyrus. As you know, they were in advance in the medical science. That is, Egyptian physicians were first described this probability of infection at the site of operation or at the site of any traumatic wound. And After that, they use that technique, that is the prevention of putrefaction. As you know, putrefaction is the process in gangrene formation. They use that technique to prevent putrefaction, and they develop mummification skill, and they develop so many mummy in their country. Till now, that mummy is persisting in Egypt, and from different corner of the world, global peoples are interested to see the mummy in the Egypt, and it is a very historical country, and as you know, Mysore is famous for mummy, and every year thousands of peoples visited that country to see the mummy, and it is the very important information regarding the antisepsis that has been developed in the Egypt first. After that, Greek developed the medical science, and ultimately they developed the concept of prophylaxis against the infection. As you know, they developed the prophylaxis against the infection, and they tried to develop the microbiological science, and after few years, Hippocrates' technique developed the antisepsis. And as you know, Hippocrates was a great surgeon and a great scientist, and he developed the medical science very much. And with the basis of the development of Hippocrates, we have developed our medical science in the next century. After Hippocratic antisepsis, that is, he uses alcohol, that is wine and vinegar, to irrigate the wounds to minimize the surgical site infection, and he practices antisepsis for throughout his life. As you know, after that, European people take over the responsibilities to develop the antisepsis, to develop the antibiotics. We like to mention the name of Robert Koch. As you know, he postulates some theory of infection and prevention of infection. And along with the Robert Koch, Sir Joseph Lister of UK and Louis Pasteur of Paris, they also tried to develop the antisepsis, and they like to prevent the infection using the theories of Hippocrates. And very important invention was penicillin, that has been invented by Alexander Fleming in 1900, as you know, in 1928, and it was a great achievement in the field of medical science. And with the development of antibiotic, there are so many improvement in the field of infection, and after that, there was remarkable reduction of the surgical site infection. as because surgical site infection is a very, very important and complicated complications of the surgery, so we should know very important aspects of the surgical site infection. How can we define surgical site infection? Actually, it is the infection at the site of surgery or surgical procedure within 30 days of performing operation. It is for the general and it is the surgery of all types of surgery except surgery where we use the prosthesis or any implants. As you know, there are so many surgery where we use prosthesis or implant. As you know, when we perform the mesh repair of hernia, then we use prosthesis. We use some materials, that is, we use proline mesh or any other synthetic mesh. Or when we perform the internal fixation of fracture, then we will use some prosthesis. So when we will use some prosthesis as or implant, in that cases infection even may occur after 1 year, as because few bacteria may remain dormant here for a long time, and when they get the opportunity, they can infect the operation site. That's why the definition of the surgical site infection is like this. That is, when the infection occur at the site of infection within 30 days of operation or 1 year after operation, 1 year within the following surgery, where prosthetic or implant materials are used. So it is divided in two parts. When we will use the prosthesis or implant, then we will consider the surgical site infection up to 1 year. But if we do not use any prosthesis or any implant, then we will consider the duration only 30 days or 1 month. I think it is clear to you. And it is frequently asked in the examination. You will meet frequently in your practice life, and you will need it in the written examination. So it is very valuable. Frequently you will get the surgical site infection, and every surgeon is interested to know from you what do you mean by surgical site infection. So again, I like to mention, it has got two parts. If we do not use prosthesis or implant, then we will consider surgical site infection when infection occurs within 30 days. And if we use the prosthesis or implant, then we will consider the surgical site infection even infection occurs within 1 year. So it is clear to you. The surgical site infection can be divided, can be further categorized into superficial incisional surgical site infection, deep surgical site infection, and organ or space. I like to say that it is divided into three parts: superficial surgical site infection, deep surgical site infection, or organ or space infection. These three part, that is, surgical site infection may be superficial, may be deep, may be organ or space. I think it is also clear to you. Superficial, deep, organ or space. I think it is clear to you. First, we will consider the superficial surgical side infection. When the infection involves the skin and subcutaneous tissue, as you know, operation over the abdomen, that is parietal wall, anterior parietal wall, that is, if we consider an infection for appendicectomy or cholecystectomy, first we will make incision over the skin and then we will cut through the subcutaneous tissue, then we go through the aponeurosis, that is, we know there are three muscles in the lateral side, and if we consider the appendicectomy operation after the skin and subcutaneous tissue, we will make incision over the external oblique aponeurosis. That is, it is the external oblique aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle. Then we will reach the internal oblique aponeurosis or muscle. Then transversus abdominis. These three muscles. These are the muscle. Parietal wall muscles. That is the just beyond the lateral margin of the rectus sheath. So, if we consider the operation just beyond the lateral margin of the rectus sheath, you will get three muscles. So, when infection is confined within the skin and subcutaneous tissue, then it is called superficial infection. But if it involves the muscles, that is, aponeurosis of the external oblique, muscle of the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis just above the parietal peritoneum, then these infection, that type of infection is called deep surgical side infection. But if it confines within the skin and subcutaneous tissue, it is called superficial surgical side infection. As you know, in all infection, there is pus formation, there is pathogenic organisms, there is some clinical, common clinical features like pain, swelling, localized tenderness, redness, etc. So, it is common for all infection. So, nothing to be described more regarding the formation of pus, isolation of the bacteria and general feature of infection, like pain, swelling and localized tenderness. And it is common to all. It is common for deep infection, common for superficial infection, even common for the organ or space infection. So, in every infection, there is some common feature. And it is true for all infection. But when we'll ask regarding the superficial infection, you will mention that when infection is confined to the skin and subcutaneous tissue at the site of operation and within 30 days of operation, that is called superficial surgical side infection. And it is the common feature, again I like to say, formation of pus, and there is always, we can identify the microorganisms by taking pus and doing culture and sensitivity test. And always there is common feature of infection like pain, swelling, localized tenderness, redness. I think it is clear to you. And if there is any problem, you can ask question, then I will answer later on. Only 33 participants. I like, my expectation was that all of you will attend the class. Next slide, you see, I already have completed the definition of deep infection. That is, when it involves the deep fascia, muscle, etc. And that is up to the peritoneum. Up to the peritoneum, when infection reaches up to the peritoneum. Here, all the events of infection occur, that is formation of pus, that is involvement of the microorganisms, that can be identified by culture and sensitivity test, and there is generalized, that is common feature of infection like fever, as well as there is soiling, there is redness, there is tenderness, and there is increased pulse, etc. All the common feature of infection is associated with this. But one thing is here, when there is deep infection, there is own disruption, that is skin is disrupted, subcutaneous tissue is disrupted, and muscles become separated, or epidermis and fascia become separated. So you will get a gap up to the peritoneum, and all the layers will be separated, and there that is called wound essence, or disruption of the wound. From here, we have learned that wound disruption or wound essence is a very important complications of surgical site infection or operations. So you also prepare yourself to write what is wound essence, wound disruption, and it is also another short note that frequently you will face in your written examinations. I think it is also clear to you. It is also a very important aspects following operations, and if you have any problem in your understanding regarding the wound essence or wound disruption, I will clear to you later on. That is, you already have learned that when there is deep surgical site infection, then skin subcutaneous tissue is disrupted or separated, and all the deep layers, that is epidermis or muscles, that has that also will separated or disrupted, and there is a gap from skin up to the parietal peritoneum. That is, here peritoneum is intact, that is the infection will not involve the peritoneal cavity, or there is no chance to involve the abdominal organ or structure or any space. So the infection is confined within the parietal wall, but there is very important event, that is wound essence or wound disruptions. It is important for you and for the surgeons, and it needs regular dressing, antibiotic following culture and sensitivity test, and after few weeks the wound will be healthy, and then we'll give secondary stitches, and the principle of treatment is like this. Now the organ or space infection. Here, you know, when there is involvement of the peritoneal space in the peritoneal cavity or any organ in the abdomen, and then it is called organ or space infection. For example, following operations of the gangrenous appendix or following operation of perforated appendix, if there is collection of pus within the pelvic cavity, as you know, it is called pelvic abscess, and space in the pelvic cavity is a dependent part, so it is frequently involved following any infected operations in the abdomen. So pelvic abscess is also a very common thing, and it is called space infection. It is the complications of operation of infected, gangrenous appendix or perforated appendix, usually that occur. And pelvic abscess is also a very complicated and life-threatening infections that needs very, very meticulous operations and attention. Very good attention is needed in such type of infection control and treatment. And here, as you know, all the features of infection is present. At the same time, we can get some palpable lump at the site of abscess formation. Or if we cannot palpate the lump, painful lump in the abdominal cavity, we can use the sonological, we can take the help of sonology or CT scan. With the sonological examination, we can find out the site of abscess formation in this space. If we perform a CT scan, it will be very clear to you regarding the site of infection and the extent of the infection. I think it is very important for you also. And sonological examination can find out the space infection, and if we perform the CT scan, that will identify the site at the same time extent of involvement of the abscess formation. This is also very important for you. And occasionally, some organ may be involved. For example, if we perform gangrenous appendix operation, some of the bacteria from the appendix through the appendicular vein and the portal vein, it may reach up to the liver, and there may be a very satellite infection within the liver, and patient may develop liver abscess. So it is the organ infection, that is, it is the complications of the gangrenous appendicitis, but complication is that there is liver abscess. So from the appendicitis, liver abscess may occur, or from the following operations, that is, operation of burst appendix or perforated appendix, bacteria may enter into the portal vein. Through that portal vein, bacteria may reach up to the liver, and patient may develop liver abscess. So it is the organ infection. Like this, there are so many examples of the organ infection. So surgical site infection is three types. Already I have explained with examples, that is, superficial surgical site infection, deep surgical site infection, and another is organ or space infection. Now we will discuss regarding some aspects of the surgical wound. It is also very important for clinical student. When we perform the operation, we will make an wound. When we will make an incision over the skin, subcutaneous tissue and deep organ, there is a surgical wound. And for the management, we classify the surgical wound into four categories. Number one is clean surgical wound. Number two, clean but contaminated. It is class two. Another is contaminated. From the very beginning, it is the contaminated. And some is so much infected that we can call it as dirty wound. And it is the class four surgical wound. Now we like to clear one by one. Clinone. Clinone is the very much creating surgical wound by incision, where there is very, very less contamination by the bacteria. For example, if there is a lipoma in the subcutaneous tissue, we like to excise the lipoma by making incision over the skin. If we prepare the skin with antiseptic solutions and we drop the operation field and make incision over the skin, then there is very less contamination of the operation site by bacteria. And this type of operation and this type of incision or wound created by surgery is called clean surgical wound. Here is very, very less chance of infection, as because it is, there is no very minimum bacteria after antiseptic wash at the site of operation. So in this type of operation, in most of the time, if the OT is very clean, very clear, and it is scientifically made, and patient is there is no infection site in the patient's body, then this type of wound do not need any antibiotic. In most of the country, they do not practice. Even we also sometimes do not practice any antibiotic for such type of wound. So it is a clean wound, and clean, and it is very, very less contaminated. Why very, very less in contaminated? As you know, the air has got some bacteria, and skin always has some common cell. When we clean it, even there is 1% of the bacteria that remain in the skin. So some bacteria may enter into the operation site, but if the bacterial percentage is very, very less, they cannot produce an infection. I will discuss this it later on. So clean wound, as we know, this is type of very infection. And this type of infection is never communicated with the respiratory system, urinary system, gastrointestinal system. If there is communication, any operation that is communicated with this system, that is not a clean wound, that is clean and contaminated. Say, for example, if we perform a cystolithotomy, cystolithotomy, that is, we open the urinary bladder by making incision over the suprapubic area, then we will open the urinary bladder to remove the stone from the urinary bladder. In that cases, the tissue above the urinary bladder initially was not contaminated, but when we will open the urinary bladder, the urine will contaminate the tissue. So the common cell, that is bacteria, usually the E. coli in the urine, will contaminate the spaces of the tissue at the site of surgery. So it is called clean but contaminated. Initially it was clean, and the urine that contained few bacteria that contaminated this area. So it is called clean and contaminated, like this. So when it is clean wound is communicated with the respiratory system, urinary system, gastrointestinal system, then it is no more clean. It is clean and contaminated. And sometimes the air may be very much polluted, or exogenous bacteria from the patients or the any person of the operation team may be infected. For example, patient underwent operation for a lipoma, but he has got two or three boils surrounding the lipoma. In that cases, from the boil, there may be some contamination of the wound. So it is not a clean operation. So if we like to have a clean operation, then after treating the boil or carbuncle or any other thing or infected site, we should perform the operation. If air is grossly contaminated by some infected person, then from the air, the operation field may be contaminated. From the infection site of a person of operation team, wound may be infected. So we should be very much careful regarding this. And if we can perform scientifically operation in a disease like lipoma or inguinal hernia in the proper way, then infection should not exceed 2%. Clean wound that can also get infected, but it should not exceed 2%. Now we should consider the clean contaminated wound. And already I have explained, if initially the surgical wound is clean, but it has got communication with the respiratory system, genitory urinary system, or the gastrointestinal system or flora, then it become contaminated. You should make some examples like cystolithotomy operation. Cystolithotomy operation by suprapubic incision. Gastrojejunostomy operation. If we perform the gastrojejunostomy operation, initially the wound is very, very clear. But when we open the jejunum and the stomach for anastomosis, then the flora from the jejunum may contaminate it, but it is very, very less, may contaminate the wound. So it is the clean and contaminated wound. It is the clean and contaminated wound. And in clean and contaminated wound, operation infection rate is about 5%, 5 to 6%, not more than that. As because here the contaminated bacteria is not so much that they can get infected. If we clean the wound after operation, washing the wound with normal saline, then the infection will be very less. Now we consider the contaminated. Say for example, you are performing the appendicectomy operation and it is gangrenous appendicectomy. So when we'll open the gangrenous appendix, a huge number of bacteria from the large guard, that is appendix is a large guard, we know here there are so many bacteria. The gangrenous appendix, when we will open, the field will be contaminated by the bacteria from the large guard. So this spirus of large guard bacteria to the operation field may contaminate the field, and there is chance of infection. And for this reason, after operating the gangrenous appendix or very perforated appendix, you should always talk with the patient or his relatives regarding the chance of infection. And the counseling is very, very, very important. Otherwise, you will be accused for infection. So you must know how you will counsel the patient. How will you take informed consent from the patients? And it is very, very, very important because to be a surgeon, you should know technique, and you should always inform the bad effect and good effect of the surgery. always you should consider all the complications that can develop. So here the infections are infections are chances so high. So you should always talk with the patient or relative regarding the high rate of infection in contaminated surgery. If you perform a contaminated surgery in a carcinoma colon, that is if you perform the resection and anastomosis, there is also a spirals of the bacteria from the large gut to the operation field. It also can infect the operation site. It is also a very dangerous bacteria. As you know, large gut is full of bacteria. Here the number of bacteria is 10 to the power 9 to 10 to the power 11 per gram of contents of the bacteria intestine in the large gut. So infection rate is so high. It is also contaminated surgery. So the already I have explained the clean surgery, clean and contaminated surgery, and contaminated surgery. Now the last one is dirty one. Dirty one. What is called dirty one? I like to mention an example. You are planning for operation over an abscess. Say for example, over a patient having a breast abscess, large breast abscess, and you like to make an incision, and you like to drain the abscess. Then it is a, you are making an incision over the very infected area, and pus will come out through the wound, and that will contaminate the skin and subcutaneous tissue. So it is a very dirty area, and here the chance of infection is more than 40%. Chance of infection is more than 40%. Another example is you are like to perform an operation in a septic abdomen following perforation of gangrenous appendix, or after perforation of the gas containing hollow viscus, like perforation of the peptic ulcer or perforation of enteric fever ulcer, that is terminal ileum is perforated following an ulcer that has been developed following typhoid, and there is gross contamination of the peritoneal cavity. There are formation of some abscess in different pockets of the peritoneal cavity. And when you will perform laparotomy and you will clean the abdomen, and a dirty abdomen, it is the dirty abdomen as because the abdomen is full of pus or infected materials. So after closing the abdomen, you can gauge that there is at least 40% chance of infection, and there is chance of wound disruption also. So you should be very much aware of this, and you should always take informed consent regarding this from the patient and its and his relatives. Now regarding some microbial organisms that frequently causes wound infection. As you know, Staphylococcus, it is the most important pus forming bacteria over the skin. So every wound is like to be contaminated by Staphylococcus aureus, and sometimes the coagulase negative Staphylococcus can also involve at the site of operation. Some Enterococcus or E. coli, that can involve at the site of infection, as because E. coli is common in GIT, at the same time it is also common in urinary tract. So our most of the operation field can be infected, can be contaminated by this type of bacteria. These are the common bacteria: Staphylococcus, E. coli, Enterococcus, and coagulase negative Staphylococcus. But Streptococcus can also involve in the, at the site of infection, and sometimes there are multiple bacteria that can involve at the site of infection. Other rare but not uncommon, that is some Staphylococcus that is resistant Staphylococcus. You know the penicillin is very much sensitive for Staphylococcus, but some of the Staphylococcus that is they develop a resistance against all type of penicillin, that is broad spectrum, narrow spectrum, all type of penicillin may be resistant, and in that cases we can think about the choice of antibiotics. In some cases there are some outbreaks of cluster of surgical site infections. What do you mean by outbreaks or cluster of surgical site infection? Outbreaks or cluster of surgical site infection, you should know what is outbreak or cluster of surgical site infection. You can write down the question: what is cluster or outbreaks of surgical site infections? When a series of infection occur from an OT following surgery, and most of the patients that has been operated in that operation theater is infected, then it is called outbreaks or cluster of surgical site infection. And that can happen if the operation theater or the materials that we use in the operation theater is not properly bacteria free, that is sterilization is very very poor, then in that cases cluster of surgical site infection can occur. Or sometimes surgical site infection may occur from a certain focus. For example, you preserve the some bacteria, some instruments in the chemicals, but within that chemicals there may be some bacteria that is permanently has been growing in that chemicals. And when you will keep your instruments from that chemicals and use the instruments, then all the surgery that you will use such type of instruments will be infected from that type of bacteria. As for example, Clostridium perfringens, it is a very important and dangerous bacteria that can develop even within the antiseptic like Sablon. And if you preserve or if you keep some your instruments, surgical instruments, within the Sablon water, and you frequently use that instruments, the wound can be contaminated by the Clostridium perfringens and it can be infected. Another important that we get frequently is the Pseudomonas. Pseudomonas is very very important in our country and it is get infected. And there are some other bacteria usually we get do not get commonly, Rhizopus and Nocardia, we get very very less. But Nocardiosis is also common in some area of the India, like Madura district of India. Here this bacteria is very very common, and with the Nocardia we call Nocardiosis that occur in the this infection occur in food in Madura district of India, and it is called Madura food.
and it is very common in that country. It is we sometimes also get it in our country also. So two bacteria is very important in our country. One is Pseudomonas, another is Clostridium perfringens. These two bacteria you should not forget. We can get cluster of infection in a operation theater. So you should be very much careful regarding the cluster infection, and that can occur in the operation theater, and we should also minimize the cluster of infection by taking appropriate antiseptic and sterilization procedure. Bacterial source may be exogenous and endogenous. What do you mean by endogenous flora, by endogenous source of bacteria? When patient himself is the source of bacteria, you know, from the skin infection, patient may get infected. From the perineum, bacteria may be, patient may get infection. From the GIT, patient may be get infected. If you perform the GIT surgery, the patient get infected from the bacteria from himself or herself. So it is the endogenous source. Operation at the perineal region get infected from the bacteria in the perineum. As you know, perineum is full of bacteria. There are so much bacteria in the perineum. So that can be infected. And few surgical wound may get infected from bacteria from the skin, either infected skin or normal flora. So patient may get infected from by Staphylococcus or even Streptococcus, and these are the endogenous organisms. And when bacterial source is not patient himself, then that source is called exogenous source, like surgical personnel. That is, if the team member, if the infection is infected organism, that is from the surgical team, that will, I like to mention that one of the member of the infected team has got some infection in his body, and patient is get infected from that side or from the patient nostrils. That can occur from patient nostrils and not patient. It is the member of the operation team, and wound can be infected. Operation theater air is also important. As you know, we like to make the operation theater very properly. That is, we always expect filter water in filter air in the operation theater proper. But if the air of the operation theater is not filtered water air, then there is about 35,000 to 40,000 bacteria per cubic millimeter of air. So this number of bacteria is very, very dangerous for the patient's wound. So we can get infected from the air of the operation theater. So we should know how we can manage the air in the operation theater. Next, all the tools, instruments and materials in the operation theater, if we do not sterile all the things properly, patient get infected from that side. That is, the instruments, the dropping materials, etc. And so we should be very much careful regarding this. Now, for any surgical wound infection, how many bacteria needed to get infected? It is also a very important issue. All infection wound is not infected, though there is always some bacteria in the surgical wound. No surgical wound is devoid of any bacteria, but we do not get infection. There is always few bacteria in the air. There is always few bacteria in the skin. Why it is not get infected? As because for the infection, a certain level of bacterial dose is required to make infection. So, bacteriologist make a theory for the chance of surgical site infection. And it is like this, as you see in the screen. That is, the risk of surgical site infection is equal to dose of bacteria contamination into virulence divided by resistance of the host, that is patient. If the patient's resistance is very, very high, few number of bacteria cannot produce an infection. So, it is inversely proportional to the patient resistance. If patient resistance is very, very high, few bacteria cannot produce an infection. But if the bacterial dose is very high, that is, the wound is very contaminated with the bacteria, then, and the bacteria is also very virulent, that will cause infection. So, if the bacterial virulence is very high, chance of infection is very more. At the same time, if bacteria is bacterial contamination is so much, then infection is also very high. One important thing you should remember, for general people having adequate resistance of the body, and if bacterial contamination is less than 10 to the power 5 number of bacteria per gram of tissue, there is less chance of infection. But if there is more than 10 to the power 5, that is 1 lakh of bacteria per gram of the tissue at the site of operation, then patient has got the chance of infection. So you can clearly understand that why clean wound do not cause an infection. That is, there is so less chance of infection. Why clean and contaminated wound, there is also less chance of infection, as because bacterial contamination is not more than 10 to the power 5 number of bacteria per gram of tissue at the site of operation. So it is also a very good thing you should remember. And I think for every clinician, it is very important, and you should have very clear idea regarding the theory of risk of surgical site of infection. But occasionally, only 100 bacteria can perform infection, as because when the patient resistance is very, very low, or if the bacteria is very, very virulent, in that cases, the even 100 bacteria per gram of tissue at the site of infection or can cause infection, or occasionally operation site is contaminated by the foreign materials. For examples, a patient having road traffic accident with very much contaminated by the foreign materials, but when you have performed surgery there, you have not cleaned the wound perfectly, that you have not cleaned the wound using normal saline or any other antiseptics, and wound has not been properly cleaned, and there is some foreign body that has been remained at the site of wound, and it will get infected. So, less bacteria may cause infection when there is very, very virulent bacteria, and the wound is contaminated by the foreign materials, or there is some dead tissue, etc. You have performed the operation, but there you have used the diathermy so much that there is so much this dead tissue that has been formed at the site of operation, then the infection will be contaminated. So surgical technique is very, very, very important. That's why we always like to say high quality of the surgical technique is very important to prevent the infection. High quality of the surgery is very, very important to prevent the infection. In the next class, we will again discuss regarding the prevention of surgical site infection. Today, I have discussed a very important chapter, that is surgical site infection, definition of the surgical site infection. There are different classes of surgical site infection, that is superficial infection, deep infection, organ or recipient infection. I have already discussed regarding different types of or class of surgical wound, that is clean wound, clean contaminated wound, contaminated wound and dirty wound. And lastly, I have discussed regarding the bacteria that can involve in the field of surgery. And last but not the least, I have asked regarding the risk of surgical site infection. So today we'll end the session here, and in the next day we'll discuss regarding the prevention of the surgical site infection. And I think you will go through the lesson, and someone that is in one of your volunteer will note down the lesson, and they will distribute it throughout all the students, those who have attended the class and those who have could not attend attend the class today. And thank you very much for your attention, and I expect more and more participation in the next class. So you should inform your friends to attend the next class. I like to know that all of you have attended in the next class. That is, in your class, you have more than 100 students. So your attendance should be like this. Thank you very much. Thank you all. সাউন্ড হয়েছিল ঠিক মতো? তোমার তো এই এইটা তো আমি